Mr. Maher Dadha of Pokhran Gallery to join Mr. Agri on the dais, please.
Maher Dadha comes from a very illustrious family from Rajasthan, settled in Chennai. Under the tutelage of his father, late L.M. Dadha, picked up the rudiments of business and skills of entrepreneurship and runs their family business, more importantly, Tamil Nadu Dadha Pharmaceuticals, a leading pharmaceutical company, having been exposed to the vast cultural and traditional heritage of Rajasthan. It was his desire to collect and preserve our art. Mr. Dadha can be recognized as an authority on colonial art in South India. He has established Dukan, which deals in antiques, and Pokhran Gallery, which deals in antiquarian books and prints. May I request Mr. Maher Dadha to deliver his much awaited speech? But before that, I request Captain Mani of The Hindu to offer the bouquet to him.
They're old friends.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank the executive committee members of the Bangalore Management Association and particularly my friend Mr. V. Raghunathan, President ING-Vysya Bank, for having given me the opportunity to render a talk on creating and managing wealth through art and investments. I suppose it would be prudent on my part to refer to a bit of historical background, which was the golden period. India has the oldest and richest civilization in the world. Lord Curzon, Viceroy of India, once hailed India's antiquity as the greatest galaxy of monuments in the world. Antiques and works of art have a legacy behind them, bringing us closer to cultures and civilization. It is interesting to note that in olden days, benevolent rulers and wealthy merchants patronized art and established some of the finest monuments and accumulated wide collection of artifacts, which fortunately to this day have survived in some of the few government museums and with the wealthy merchants and with very few corporate houses in India. It is a well-known fact that captains of industry are the connoisseurs of art and also creators and curators of some of the finest private collections and museums in the world, like Paul F. Walter Collection, Rockefeller Foundations, Mildred Archer's and Mark Manustein, to name a few. Likewise, in India, we also have a few known examples like Kelkar Collections, Tal Khandalwala Collections, Birla Museums, Kolkata, Calico Textiles Museums in Ahmedabad, and Rusi Modi's private collections, to just name a few, and also not to forget Air India and Tata Group of Companies collection. And not to forget, where is Mr. Raghuna? Without you, I'm uncomfortable.
Thanks. But I wouldn't be able to see this if I don't.
Okay, fine.
I'll sit right here.
Because he is my inspiration to come over here today. And not to forget that our own Mr. V. Raghunathan's collection of more than 400 locks is the single largest collection of working locks in India, or maybe in the whole world, which I am sure gives him more pleasure than the commercial worth of the whole collection. However, if Mr. Raghunathan desires to encash his collection today, it would fetch him a fortune, for there are many who would like to acquire his entire collection of his love and labor, which has no value. Likewise, many individuals who have wisely invested in works of art over the years, out of their small savings, have grown into large private collections. Unfortunately, due to our own negligence and ignorance, we find Indian antiques more in Western museums and in private collections than in India itself. The best case of this is none other than India Office Library in London and Smithsonian Institute in USA and various other private collections world over, which were taken away from our country due to lack of interest and also underdeveloped economic situations in the last 50 years of our independence. I would like to narrate a small example over here, which literally brought me into this field of leaving my family business of pharmaceuticals and other things and devoting full time into antique business. Mr. Douglas Barrett was primarily a collector and a curator of the British Museum and an authority on colonial art. Used to visit India every year for the last 30 years till he lived. And so some of the finest original works which were available in abundance at very cheap price even in those days. I recall my personal visit to experience in early 1976, and to be very precise it was September 1976 when I happened to meet a retired caretaker of Pudukkottai Palace Library who showed me one painting not knowing what it was and its worth and told me, "Sir, there were no buyers for such works in those days in India and some foreigner took trunkloads of them for few thousands of rupees," which are all original works depicting the final days of Mysore War in 1791, painted by none other than Sir Robert Hyde Colebrooks, whose works would fetch more than 50,000 to a lakh of dollars in any international auction today. What a sad story that such instances have occurred throughout the early 1960s and late 70s, when we were all engrossed in economic development of the country and creating wealth for ourselves, ignoring in the process that we were losing our own precious heritage and history. I could narrate many such instances which I should now at least open our conscience and coffers to collecting our own history and heritage object the arts. At this point of time I would just like to interrupt and come back to you. I happened to just come from Delhi yesterday and I met the Director of Archaeological Survey of India. And there is a very interesting note he gave me which they have presented to the government for amendments to the Art and Antiquities Act of 1972. The subject of that is, I would not like to take it quite long, if anybody is interested could ask for a photocopy of this, is Smugglers Making Hay with Indian Antiques. And this report was submitted on 27th May to the Finance Ministry by the CBI. In response to a very, very important allegations put against the auction house in that is Bowrings last month. And there he refers, I'll just read the first few lines of it and then come back to the crux of the point, is that commercialization of illicit trafficking and antiquities. From the famous Shivapura Natarajas to the stucco heads of Buddha of Nalanda, thousands of Indian antiques are smuggled out of India with alarming regularity to museums and private collections abroad thanks to lax laws and lack of proper documentation. Sculptures, miniature paintings, illustrated or painted manuscripts or even leaves taken out of them, clocks and jewelry, declared antiques, statues from temples, from all forms of the thriving trade which many a times is carried under the guise of handicraft exports, says Mr. C.B. Mishra, Deputy Superintendent Archaeologist of the Archaeological Survey of India. About 2,870 pieces of cultural property, including antiques, worth over 600 crores, were stolen during the year 1996 alone in our country, out of which only 656 were recovered according to the latest report of the National Crime Records Bureau, and this has been circulated to the Scotland Yard and world over. There is an interesting anecdote he is mentioning in this report, which is officially Government of India report submitted for inclusion in the amendments. India's rich art and cultural heritage fascinates people from time immemorial, but the smuggling started from the time of the British, who incidentally were the first to undertake archaeological research in the country, says Mr. Manji. Through the British set up many museums in India, valuable pieces were also whisked away to Britain. Sculptures from Amravati in Maharashtra, were sent in bulk. The marble bath in Shahjahan's palace was auctioned off, and they were given plans to dismantle the Taj and auction its marble. If you can imagine, that is the fate of our country. In the revised scenario of economic prosperity, we are now seeking to acquire and preserve our own heritage when, sadly, majority of our collections is in the hands of private and corporate collectors of the Western nations, who are reaping huge profits by offering Indian works in various international auctions where they fetch record prices compared to any other works of art or antiques in the world. I would like you to just glance through some of them. I am trying to show a few auction records from 1995. Christie's have been regularly, it was in 1994, Christie's started a sale devoted to Indian art. Then it was called as Visions of India and Views of India sales. Where you will find the price, what was estimated in the public auction and what price they have realized, it will show you. So just spare a few minutes to go through this to get, I won't disturb you in between. Futures, an American poet once commented that money and art are far apart. I beg to differ and state that art and money are two sides of the same coin and currency. To understand the close relationship of both art and money, just take out a currency note from your pocket. Literally, you could take out some, please. And look carefully. It is surprising that we always carry a piece of art with us unconsciously. I am sure many of us may not have bothered to observe the intricacy of artwork that each currency note contains. What better example do we need to demonstrate the affinity between money and art? It is art that makes currency notes highly intricate and rare, that we excitedly handle every day, and art has the power to make more and more money. In today's talk, I would like to dwell upon the investment on arts. When we talk of investment, our mind oscillates around the traditional choice like land and building, gold and diamonds, fixed deposits, bonds, stock and shares. Many of us are unaware of the gold mine that is just around us. It is the collection of art as assets that is both a pleasure and treasure. And the wonderful feel that brings socio-economic benefits to such persons who have indulged in acquiring art over the years. I would now like to briefly dwell upon the merits of investment on art and antiques. Primarily, it provides aesthetic beauty, personal enjoyment, and affirms a distinctive lifestyle that was once pursued by kings and wealthy merchants. Initially, it may give you only visual pleasure, joy of possession, then over the years transform itself into heirlooms of immense wealth for posterity. 2. It is believed that antiques are best hedged against inflation. as long as it is acquired out of your allocable profits or had been returned off as an indulgent expenditure. And finally, only a fraction of your savings have been invested in art. It would go a long way in creating interest and excitement of acquiring antiques for pleasure along with making huge profits. 3. Art and antiques are immune to the vagaries of inflation and recession. It may be exaggeration, but their value multiplies faster than that of plots and platinums. What is more, they transcend the barriers of country and currency, and I may add color of the currency also, as they can be traded internationally. And finally, since they are unique and limited in supply, they are not prone to obsolescence and depreciation, which is proved that even after September 11, the Art of India sales on 27 September in London was a roaring success in terms of price realization ever in public auctions. Every rupee or dollar spent on purchase of art and antiques grows exponentially, bringing both fortunes, sure fortunes for the indulgent and the collector. Here at this point of time, I would like you to please observe this was Art of India sales conducted by Christie's after September 11. And everybody was talking that it should be cancelled and postponed. The Christie's insisted that we will continue with the sale, and they recorded the highest ever price received for Indian works of art after September 11. Watch this item. At least 25,000 pounds, more than a lakh of pounds. This is a very interesting incident which just happened 30 days back. On 10th of October 2002, Sotheby's, who are world's number 2 auction house after Christie's, had this small cameo of Shahjahan put up in their auction, and it was estimated at 600 to 800 pounds. And it was sold for 750 pounds and bought by a dealer in London. He immediately after buying went to Bonhams, which is number 4 in order of turnover and international ranking in auction houses, and showed them. And they said, yes, it's something very unusual and it could go in the range of 30 to 40,000 pounds. He said, you must be crazy, when just a month back, Sotheby's are put in their catalogue and it was valued at 600 to 800 pounds. He said, we are willing to put at 40 to 50,000 reserve price. If you are keen to put it, you put. He put this piece in the auction, which was held on 1st of May 2003. And it was estimated at 40 to 60,000 pounds. And to everybody's surprise, it was sold for 5,25,000 pounds. Imagine, there is no, and this is the newspaper which carries the headlines showing this. So, I'm sure, gentlemen, I could be more interesting, but I am not used to talking professionally like this to an audience. I am more comfortable talking to individual at one-to-one level, where I can interact more freely. Here I am made to coordinate my speech with this man over here, with this and my script in my hand. I am not comfortable like this.
The idea is to reduce your price,
quotation price. No, the idea is to increase the price. Why should you reduce the price?
I am talking of the interaction.
Oh. Yes. Now, it is in this context that I would like to quote the famous phrase of Victor Cousin, art for art's sake. With due respect to this French philosopher, I would like to rewrite this phrase as art for asset's sake. Gentlemen, now coming to what are the different investment options in art and antiques. 1. Paintings. It is one of the oldest forms of antiques ever created and still available to this day in abundance for collectors to indulge in acquiring, like oil on canvas, Turkey school paintings and watercolors. No two paintings could be identical, and hence each work is unique and custom made by the artist, which makes it most ideal investment in terms of returns. 2. Antiquarian prints. The great artists of the past regarded prints as a worthy medium of wider expressions and exposure to masses, knowing very well that the original paintings would be only one, and that too beyond the reach of all. Hence a fine etching, engraving, aquatint or lithograph would not be so. As you all know, Raja Ravi Varma, who painted primarily for the royalties all over India till 1906. His works were eagerly sought after by all Maharajas and Zamindars, and since they were commissioned works, they were not in public view. It was then that Raja Ravi Varma decided to make copies of his most famous works for the general masses at affordable prices, and he established a lithographic press in Lonavala in 1893. Incidentally, Ravi Varma print oleographs, when I talk about it, it means is the famous Lakshmi, Saraswati and God Goddesses images which you find invariably in every Hindu house, and started producing millions of oleographs of his famous works, which were sold all over India and adorned the walls of the many houses. These prints were available till 1970s for less than rupees 250, which by 1980s rose to 750, and in 1990s to about rupees 2500, which presently has gone to around rupees 5000. And unfortunately, gentlemen, at this prices also, it is not freely available. What better proof of appreciation would you expect compared to any other form of investments? Antiquarian prints have always been a favorite subject for collectors. It is possible to assemble a fairly good and large collection to suit the most modest of resources and to please more or less any taste. They can be framed and hung on walls or stored and transferred. Prints have their own variation depending on the editions and strength of image. Collectors could gradually improve upon their knowledge and also collection. 3. Furnitures. It is by far the most popular category of antiques for collectors and connoisseurs alike. No one would really think of acquiring any period furniture since they are too expensive and seldom available. Even if one desired to buy, the best way to indulge a taste for fine furniture is to start collecting colonial furniture, which is not that expensive and still available in fairly good quantities. Compared to contemporary, machine-made, molded furnitures, which would invariably depreciate in value, like your workstations or office partitions made of particle boards, would have to be destroyed after use. On the contrary, a solid teak wood, rosewood or mahogany furniture would appreciate in value as time passes, since forest reserves are fast depleting and timber is getting scarce. 4. Works of art and collectibles. This is the most beautiful and exciting form of art and antique, which is also highly decorative and visible form of investments, which enhances the ambience of your house and office equally. And the most preferred form of gifts presented to visiting heads of state or your beloved ones. This category is unlimited in its scope with regards to medium, variety and range. It is very important to discuss now the source of identifying and authenticating works of art for investment and trading. Consultation in matter of authenticity. Before seeking consultation or even desiring to acquire any object or antiques or prints, the foremost thing is it should appeal you and your better half and suit your requirements also. Then analyze the authenticity of the dealer who is selling it. Object, his knowledge on the item. then seek maximum information from the dealer about the piece, from available references and catalogs. And still, if you are not satisfied, then it is advisable to seek consultation from experts. Internationally, they are available, and of late in India also, Bowrings have opened their offices in Delhi, Bombay, Calcutta, and hope their Bangalore representative is here. Anisha, is she there? Sorry. She was supposed to be here and give a talk for 2 minutes on behalf of Bowrings. So. Then seek an expert from opinion or from these Bowrings people. Auction houses are providing free consultation and valuation for any objects we are world over, and fortunately in India also we have Bowrings. The most important thing which we should do all is to form exclusive collectors club. Like in USA and UK, it is very common to find Wedgwood Collectors Association, Royal Dalton Collectors Association, or Chippendale Furniture Collectors Association, and they form association between themselves, exchange views and share their collection and increase their knowledge. That is what is required for awareness and interest to be created amongst them. So we have to form clubs, association, like kitty parties are held. Everybody has kitty party and goes religiously. Likewise, we can have, in fact, I was discussing with Mr. Raghunathan also, and he said that is a good idea. We should have clubs of specific persons interested in furniture or art or paintings, and interact and share information like what we have. And for the information and knowledge of the audience, I have brought a lot of reference book here, which I'm afraid I will not be able to lend it out, but if anybody can go through them. It will really create interest and increase your knowledge on specific subjects. The most important thing which I was mentioning is exclusive collectors club. Exchange views and share your collections and information amongst members. Prior to that, we start collecting maximum reference catalogs on art and antiques and start circulation among corporate companies, individuals, which would create awareness and interest amongst new collectors. This will by itself create a market for art and antiques, since supply is limited and demand would increase due to the wider awareness and exposure, giving good returns on your investments. For your information, the Indian law on antiquity is very safe and friendly, as long as it is bought and sold within the country, even if it is more than 100 years old object. In fact, if anybody has got any antiques or any objects which is more than 100 years old, they can just send an intimation to the Archaeological Survey of India and then it gets recorded. You don't have to wait for that, but you have to only intimate to the government that I am in possession of an object. And they do not restrict you from again sending it back to anybody, as long as it is sold in the country. Only if you are exporting it or selling it outside the country, it creates a problem. Ladies and gentlemen, I have taken a lot of your valuable time and hopefully not your patience. Should anybody wish to seek more information on merits of investment in art and antiques in relation to creating and managing wealth in the form of heirlooms, it would be my privilege to meet personally at your convenience, preferably with prior intimation, to share my views and opinions. I am sure you would not regret should you ever consider to invest small portion of your savings or capital in antiques on long-term basis, both for pleasure and profits. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Maher Dadha.
For all the mind-boggling information, can I request Mr. Raghu, his inspiration, as he says, to give him a small token.